Hello, welcome to the EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Sarala Gopalan, formerly Secretary to Government of India in the Ministry of Human Resource Development and Department of Women and Child. I have worked in this area of women and child for quite a number of years and have also been documenting various developments and participated in the policy formulation and implementation of a variety of programs for women's development, as it was known earlier, and later empowerment of women. I am very happy to be with you all today and share the problems in evolving the various concepts, making the various programs and implementing them for the benefit of women, to bring them on an equal status with men in all areas of social, economic, political and cultural level. So, in this narration, I am going to discuss the various steps taken to create a conducive environment for women to come forward, how they were considered as recipients of benefits or beneficiaries earlier, and all programs were directed towards their welfare. Later on, it was changed to development, not welfare but development, because they were also to participate in the process of social, economic and political development. In the third phase, it was felt that they have to be empowered. They should empower themselves, and also government should create the environment for them to get empowered by introducing various tools, mechanisms and inculcating in them self-confidence and the concept of empowerment. So, I am going to discuss these matters in this lecture today. The social reformers in the 19th century analyzed the various problems women faced in the Indian society due to a variety of cultural factors, and all the legislation that was available in the society at that time was based on the cultural factors, and therefore some of them were very restrictive for women's advancement. For instance, women did not enjoy any right to property, and therefore without any entitlement to property, they were denied a social position or a status in their own family as well as in their community and outside. Therefore, the reformers felt it was very important to give them a status and a dignity right from the institution of the family, in their marriage, in their married life and all through life. And they needed to be given attention, specific care as they needed it, and not be neglected, because the earlier cultural practice, despite the veneration for the goddesses, the women in the homes were neglected. They sometimes lost themselves, lost even nutrition and health in trying to look after other persons in the family. And then in marriage, should they become a widow after losing their husband, they almost faced destitution. So the social reformers emphasized the need to change a great deal of legislation which confined women to the very subservient position. The landmark in this social reform process has been the Hindu Succession Act of 1956. Whereby women were given right to property, equal share in the father's property as their brothers. This was a big landmark, though the actual implementation of this took many, many years, because very often women themselves relinquished their rights to the property because of the family circumstances where they were goaded to do this. However, once the law came and in years women were made aware, families were made aware that women also need to be given equal right in the property. Now this has come into vogue and women have achieved an equal status in the family with their brothers with regard to immovable property. Now from the old time, they have been given earlier, it was called Stridhan, that they were given movable property like jewelry and others on marriage, and later it assumed the form of dowry, and in the dowry they got quite a lot of money, sometimes lot of jewelry, and this in the years that followed has become a point of harassment for women. So we have even today cases where the daughter-in-law is harassed by the husband and the mother-in-law, father-in-law, sisters-in-law for not bringing adequate dowry, or the parents of the girl being pestered incessantly to give various kinds of gifts. It is good if the parents could afford to give it. But where the parents cannot afford to give that, they started harassing the daughter-in-law in the house and made her life miserable. So what we can see is every good step that has been taken forward has also got other side of problems where society tries to exploit the lady. Therefore, it is very important for us to understand the cultural factors that dominate all legislation, all advancement of women in this society, and see how we can overcome the discrimination, the harassment, and the elimination of violence against women. So, side by side with creating a conducive environment by making legislation where she gets equality before law, which the Constitution of India has pronounced very strongly, she also has to get that conducive environment to live, because the law is on one side, she can't be going to court all the time. However, in the years to follow, the government of India created family courts to settle disputes between man and wife. In cases where needed to be separated or divorced, clear legal provisions were made. Earlier, even if a lady wanted to come out of a marriage because she was being harassed, she could not do that. Whereas a man could easily get a divorce. Now, after divorce, she could not get maintenance. She could not get custody of children. So, in all these manners, she was being deprived. And therefore, to create a very conducive social environment for the woman in this country, laws have been legislated for divorce, for marriage, and then for prohibiting dowry. This was done in 1961 and amended again in 1986, where any death of a married woman within 7 years of marriage was considered to be a dowry death, and punishment under the IPC, the Indian Penal Code, was also prescribed. I must share with you here that when I visited the Tihar jail somewhere in the 90s, I found that the women's ward of the prison was 90% occupied by women who had been put on trial, some of them serving a sentence, for harassing the daughter-in-law. Of course, large number of cases were still on trial, and then for many years, the women had to be in jail. Recently, there is a judgment by the Supreme Court where they have said, please look at this provision. Unnecessarily, women under trial are kept in the prison for very long years. There has to be a quick conclusion. Otherwise, and the family also suffers. Supposing at the end of the trial, you are not going to punish the lady, you have unnecessarily kept her in jail, prison for so many years, deprived her of her advancement, as also the family of her services. So it's social issues are very complex. Even if you make legislation looking at one problem, then there are other problems which need to be solved. So we need to change mindsets of people to create an equitable society where every person is honored and given an opportunity to self-realize, develop, and contribute to the society. So, in the creation of the conducive environment, one side is the strategic requirement of making the law conducive to women's advancement, and on the other side, changing the mindset of the people and creating an enabling environment. Very often, girls are not able to go to school. One reason is that the school is not close to their home and they cannot walk long distances. It's very unsafe for them to walk. Once I asked somebody who had come from Uttar Pradesh as to why the girls' education is so low and they are not going to school, they said, "Madam, with all our wheat fields, when the girls walk through the field long distances, they get molested, and because of the tall wheat crop, nobody can see what is happening, and that becomes a big hazard for girls to set out of their house, walk through the fields and go to school." Then government, they brought in a system where they said all primary schools should be within 1 kilometer of the habitation so that the girls can go to school. Next was, there were schools, I have seen in one community, where there was a school within 50 feet. But at the same time, the girls are not going to the school beyond a third standard. Because by the time they are 8 or 9 year old, they don't want to go to school if there is not a female teacher there. If there is only one teacher and that is a male teacher, they are scared. They will be harassed, they will be molested. So the parents don't want to send them to school. Of course, there's the other side, they also want the girl to stay home and do all the work or graze the cattle, and then she cannot develop. Earlier, you see, we thought, you know, we must administer welfare. Our constitution also was a welfare society constitution, where you thought of disbursing welfare to the people. But slowly we understood that, and the world understood, that if women have to advance, they should be considered as partners in development. In India, of course, we have been going through 5-year plans right from 1952 until recently when we completed the 11th plan. And after 2014, we have not had a plan because the planning commission stands abolished. But we have had so many strategies in all these plans. The first plan was completely welfare oriented. There were the National Extension Service, the community development blocks, which tried to approach women in the rural areas to give them awareness about their health, some minimum education, about child care and so on. And there was the Central Social Welfare Board in parallel, which gave grants to all voluntary organizations in the rural areas to do the same task. Some cases, sometimes to give them also some capital for earning income and coming out of their poverty. In the second plan, the National Extension Service and the Community Development Program emphasized on women's groups called Mahila Mandals at the grassroots level, and a lot of welfare schemes were implemented through these Mahila Mandals for the benefit of women. But the approach was still one of welfare. It was mostly distribution of nutrition and giving them lessons on nutrition, child care and cleanliness, hygiene and so on. But by the time we crossed 1960, and then our third plan was introduced in 1961, and fourth plan followed, and there are also a few interim rolling plans till 1964. In that period, the child and maternal health were considered as very important for the progress of women, because we were having lot of women dying in childbirth, lot of children dying at infancy, and in order to curb this, it was necessary that the women had education, access to proper nutrition, and the concentration was on these factors apart from giving better education to girls. Of course, side by side we can see that during this period, law also was enacted to see that the age of marriage for girls was increased to 18 years from 15 years, which was prevalent in the society. And for boys, the age of marriage was made 21 years and above, so that child marriage could be avoided. Otherwise, we found in India that by the time a girl has crossed 15, she is already a mother. By the time she's crossed 30 years, she is already a grandmother. So where is the time for her to get advancement for herself, learn and get skills, etc.? So she was confined to the home because she had to take care of the child, and then later as a grandmother. And then we have seen that women have different problems at all ages. Infancy, there is a problem. Childhood, there is a problem. Adolescence, there is a problem. And then after marriage, they have childbirth, and that problem is there as mother. And then as they age, old age also brings along with it several problems. Therefore, to approach women's health, you have to look at this life cycle and the specific needs at each age of the woman and give her the specific requirement for combating the problems that are age related. Therefore, programs also started slightly changing their emphasis. Though the women's movement has been complaining against government, saying that all the time you are focused on child care and reproductive health and you are not tackling the other health problems of women, you are making them only guinea pigs for experimenting various family planning programs and so on, and you're not having the real proper and sound health of women in mind. And therefore, because of this badgering, to some extent government have changed their approach and slowly moved from exact welfare and centering on only woman's motherhood to the total health of the woman, both as mother and the good care of the child who is born to her. Because they found that unless there is assurance that a child born is going to survive, they cannot control the number of children a woman would have. It was important to make sure that the children born were healthy and grew up well. And then they found that the lady has to be given skills. So by the time we came to the sixth plan, five-year plan, that is 1980-85, the emphasis was on a multidisciplinary approach where the education, where health, skill development, all are focused together so that the woman can come out of poverty and live a good quality of life. Therefore, the sixth plan is looked upon as a landmark in the economic and social development of India's development programs, where specific programs were tailored towards this. the following plan, 7th plan, which was from 85 to 90, there were several programs for mainstreaming women, to bring the women on the mainstream as partners in manufacturing, partners in skill development, in all avenues of life, in delivery of all kinds of services that the society requires. Because this was important to raise the economic and social status of women, as well as make them very useful to the society. And the approach was not welfare but development, and bring women into the mainstream development of the society. They called it mainstreaming women's needs. So consider all women's needs as social needs for improvement and advancement. And thereafter, several programs, like for instance, to give you an example, women were earlier and continued doing dairy as their livelihood. Now, in order to mainstream, the Women and Child Development Department started programs where they would give grants for a large group of women, like say 500 women, who could start a dairy cooperative. They'll be given training on how on animal husbandry. They would be given credit to purchase the animals. They could form a cooperative. And because in the other dairy cooperatives, they were not made members. But in these specific cooperatives, not only they became members, but they could even become chairpersons. So a number of all women dairy cooperatives were started, and they were merged with the dairy development program that was current in the country. Wherever the dairy development program was doing well, in the milk route, women were also able to come together and participate in that development and participate in the white revolution for which India is famous. Government then started in 92-97. There was the development and empowerment approach to women. That was what was decided in the World Conference, and then followed by the various machinery that government started. There was the Rashtriya Mahila Kosh, where there was a separate fund created for lending money to women and their enterprises. And there was the NABARD, which was asked to give funding through the banks to women's groups. Women entrepreneurs were trained by the Small Industries Department, and then a lot of microcredit programs developed, which have an excellent record of performance. And then finally in 96, the National Policy for Empowerment of Women was introduced. And in the 2000s, the National Policy for Empowerment of Women got established, which talked about multi-sector emphasis for women's development and made it the task of every department to look after how they did towards their women. And therefore, the component plan, you know, the allocation of funds in every ministry was to be monitored to see how much of that goes to women. But then when they totaled everything and saw, they found that hardly 1% of the budget went for women's advancement and development. And they have made a remark that when you allocate more money for women and their advancement, certainly you will find larger strides of development in the economy than when you do not allocate money for women's development and advancement. And there was a parliamentary committee of both the Rajya Sabha and Lok Sabha together to monitor the implementation of a whole bunch of programs meant for women under various ministries and departments and agencies of the government. So all of this was aimed at empowering women, and at the same time, by then the legislation, 1993 Constitution Amendment, had brought in women into governance through the panchayat elections. So panchayat presidents, panchayat members are all women, and they got an opportunity to implement programs for the benefit of women. Of course, this is of various degrees of excellence in different parts of the country, depending on how advanced the state is on its social indicators of education, skill development, health development. But slowly we are improving. What we desire is a much faster rate of improvement, so that we can be in parallel with many of the advanced countries. In India itself, we have some parts like Kerala where all these social development indicators are very high, and we have some other parts where these social development indicators are very low and women do not have access. But we noticed, whether it is developed countries, developed states in the country, there is a glass ceiling. Women cannot go above the glass ceiling. They have to break it, and for that they have to fight even harder they have done so far. So I would like to conclude that we must now consider that actions taken will try to pierce this glass ceiling, not just make every girl a primary class pass. Every girl should at least become a graduate. If not a graduate, at least pass 10th standard so that she can fend for herself. She can acquire skills. She can avail the opportunities for economic development that is available in the socio-economic scenario of the country. Otherwise, she'll be lagging behind. And if she lags behind, she will be confined to the home oppression and suppression. Today, women are no longer silent. They are coming out and they are complaining. And only that will change the mindset of men. No longer are they toys in the hands of boys and men who are only using them and not looking at them as persons who have a responsibility and duty towards the community and society and in the family, and who can deliver a lot of good things to rest of humanity. So that mindset we have to change, and we have to change the mindset for women themselves by empowering them to understand their dignity as a person, as an individual. Therefore, our aim has to be that. And to conclude, I have to tell you that I have traced the history of the course of development in the national policies of the government, of the various ministries involved in looking at women, in providing various legislative measures and various development measures for the advancement of women, not as just beneficiaries, but as partners in development. Thank you.